A lot on the line for both of these players. They've both had incredible seasons, and this is just another something they put on their resume. As the game is just about to get started, we're going to see Pramawat's prizes. One double colorless prize, nothing too relevant outside of that.
Yeah, one Combi, not the worst, but of course you'd like to have those.
Going over to Azul's side.
Nope.
Two Lele's.
Yeah, that's not good.
And we are off with the first match of this top eight here for Madison, the last regionals in the U.S., Michael Pramawat versus Azul Garcia. Tell me how this matchup goes, because I think it might be a little bit different than most people are thinking.
You'd think that, Azul's playing a fire deck, and Michael is playing a grass deck, so that should be unfavored, right? Well, not necessarily. Pramawat has options where he can do so much damage with his Vespaquin deck. Also, that Eevee is a huge piece, not for attacking necessarily, but just because when a Vaporeon comes in, this Vespaquin now can target down with a water weakness on Volcanion. And that means that he needs less Pokemon in the discard pile in order to take a knockout.
Yeah, Pramawat choosing to run both the Flareon that turns your stage ones into fire types and the Vaporeon that turns into water types, going to help him a lot here versus this all fire, besides the star you see on your board, all fire deck.
Yeah, there are a couple of double types with Volcanion there too. We see that Michael decided to Acrobike, discarding Special Charge. Special Charge can be very important in matchups where an opponent has Pokemon that are not EX Pokemon or GX, but without special charge, he can just use double colorless, and three double colorless could win games.
And we do see that Pramawat also chooses not to Professor Sycamore, maybe due in part to having the second special charge in his hand. Doesn't want to get rid of that many special energy, out special energy if he has to.
Yep.
And he gets rewarded by Azul's N.
Yeah, he also had Vespaquin in his hand already, I believe, so he was going to be able to have a little bit of a setup. Of course, his deck's not nearly as slow as decks like Connor's that we saw earlier that would take this risk and play very slow. Azul, though, says, I'm going to end you anyways, so it doesn't matter too much.
Both players getting reset back to six cards in their hand. What does Azul's optimal turn one look like here?
Well, I believe that it starts with Baby Volcanion and it ends with a Combi in the discard pile. So he does find Baby Volcanion fire energy. Staryu has free retreat, so it is up active, and it doesn't take much to knock out that 40 hit point Combi because of that weakness.
Yeah, well, there is a knockout. Azul doing exactly as intended.
And this was the difficult part about Pramawat's opening turn, how slow it was. He didn't get a Zorua or a Combi down, so that means that he would have to find a Forest of Giant Plants to even get a Vespaquin down this turn, and he has to get a lot of Pokemon into the discard pile if he wants to knock out this Volcanion with 130 hit points. So a pretty slow turn for Pramawat, and he might be forced to even Sky Return, just try to remove this Pokemon EX off of the field, or something that isn't a knockout on this Volcanion. Not what he wants to be doing as a Vespaquin deck.
Yeah, absolutely not. We see an Oranguru going into Pramawat's hand. That Instructability been really big over the weekend. All the Vespaquin decks, we even saw Danielle Tavilla's Zoroark Drampa deck play.
We've seen Pramawat attack with Oranguru.
Oh yeah,
well,
we've seen Pram go deep on Oranguru for sure. We see a double colorless does attach to that Shaymin, potentially setting up for a Sky Return. Second Combi, very nice for Pramawat to have.
But his hand is Choice Band, Forest of Giant Plants, now Shaymin and double colorless as well. But it's on Azul now to keep this pressure on. He's got Oranguru has so many hit points for just a basic Pokemon that doesn't do too much. So this is actually pretty difficult for Azul to knock out. He probably just is going to try to advance his board state a little with extra energies from the combination of Steam Up and a Power Heater. So we'll see if he's able to do that and keep the heat on, as we say.
Volcanion EX does hit the bench.
Oh, that is perfect.
Lysander on the Combi. Energy on the Turtonator. And we're going to see another Combi knockout. Even getting to attach an energy with that Power Heater attack to that Turtonator. See our first Vespaquin of the game from Pramalot.
That's very creative of Azul to use the Turtonator as one of his big attackers. He could even just use that first attack, and that would start. It would make it very difficult for Pramalot to take knockouts on it.
There's the DCE Choice Band on the Vespaquin. Revitalizer gonna go ahead and do a counterintuitive play to an extent and get two Combis back for Pramalot. Thanks to Forest of Giant Plants, that Combi immediately becomes a Vespaquin, and Shaman's setup draws him a fresh hand of five new cards and the remaining Combi.
Yeah, that's a big board state for him, especially when we already saw two Combis fall, and now he's got two Vespaquin ready to go, and it looks like he's just needs to find. Does he have? I don't know how many Pokemon he has in this card pile, but I would suspect he needs a few more. That Vaporeon will help a lot, though. Now with weakness on the table.
Yeah, this is what you were saying. It's kind of the key to the matchup is having that Vaporeon. Not every player in this top 8 has chosen to play the Vaporeon, but I'm sure Pramalot is glad that he has. Turning all of Pramalot's stage 1 Pokemon that happens to be all of his attackers and Zoroark and Vespaquin into water types. If you look in the lower left corner of your screen, you see that Volcanion is weak to water. So is all the other Pokemon that Azul is going to want to attack with.
Yep, we see now Michael is going to get himself 6 fresh cards. Azul only 4, a little punished for his aggressive start in this game. And Michael is going to be in a relatively good spot. Of course, facing down a Turtonator is not what you want to do, but you got to get going at this point. It's been a slow few turns for you, and now it's time to put on that aggression yourself.
So does Turtonator do anything special in this matchup, or is it all just kind of one-hit KOs either way if everything's going right?
Yeah, I mentioned that the Shell Trap attack, it can be interesting. You can attack it. It's only 20 damage, but of course with Power Heater, Steam Up, you can make that attack do 50, which would then be 100 to the Vespaquin, which is enough. And then possibly the 8 damage counters from being attacked into could be relevant. It's difficult with Zoroark and Vespaquin being above 80 hit points, obviously. But having that extra damage, it's never gonna hurt you.
Yeah, if things go wrong for Azul, having that 8 damage counters can randomly be good. But most of it is gonna be exchanging one-hit KOs. Seems like we're gonna get a count on the amount of Pokemon in Pramalot's discard pile.
Doesn't need a lot. He's got 3, and that's gonna be plenty.
Yep, and that's a knockout. Pramalot at 5 prizes, Azul at 4 remaining.
Yep, now Azul loves to have that Staryu out simply for the free retreat. Doesn't need Starmie just yet. And it gives him a couple options. Although Azul has gotten off to a pretty strong start with the double Combi knockout with the use of Lysander, he hasn't been able to get too much going as far as a board presence. He just has that Turtonator down.
We do have that Turtonator on your screen. New card, pretty interesting addition to this Volcanion deck. Azul Ultra Balls for a Tapu Lele GX, Wonder Tags for a Professor Sycamore.
Yeah, we see that Azul had Delinquent at his disposal there. Michael had 4 cards, so it wouldn't have been too bad. But of course, he also has that Oranguru on the bench, which means that Delinquent never hurts him too bad. But resources could be important. Say his hand was special charges and double colorless energies. That would be pretty great to force him to discard.
Absolutely. We have. So, what do you. Let's just go over the prediction. Who do you predict is going to win this match?
Yeah, coming into this game, I believe that Michael Pramalot is favored. And I also think that it's really difficult for Azul to win this matchup, anyways. The fire weakness doesn't matter too much. And just the fact that Michael has that Vaporeon to put less of a burden on throwing all of his Pokemon into the discard pile to hit those big numbers to knock out EX and GX Pokemon is really going to help him. So I'd say that Michael should be able to pull this victory out, It doesn't mean that Azul's counted out at all, but it's definitely an uphill battle.
Yeah, I think the matchup favors Premwatt as well, especially with that Vaporeon. Just seems like things are going his way. In fact, we had Azul was backstage just before the match started, and he was talking about the bracket. And he goes, who does Prem play next?
Yeah.
Just kind of a
just already looking at what Premwatt's top four matchup would be.
So Azul doesn't exactly have the confidence in himself, but you never know how things can go. Prem, we've seen the Vespiquen deck win a lot on camera, but we've also seen it lose a lot. We've seen it lose to itself a lot by getting Oricorio'd out of the game or maybe not having as much energy as it needs to. So a lot of things can happen here, but I do think Azul is fighting an uphill battle.
Yeah, a deck that's as explosive as Michael's, it also means that it's risky. You could have turns where you might be losing your double colorless energies because you needed to Sycamore there, or when you Acrobike, you get two cards that you don't want to throw away.
There's an attachment from the hand onto that Volcanion EX from Azul. Nope. He's taking it back and to consider what's going on.
Yep, picking his attackers wisely here because Volcanion doing 130 damage really isn't necessary. He'd much rather have Baby Volcanion. It can handle all of the Pokemon pretty much on this board besides Oranguru. But he just hasn't been able to find one since that opening turn.
That Starmie hitting the board for Azul is going to allow him to discard a card from his hand to get back two energy cards from his discard pile. That's going to be important for the Steam Up abilities here, adding damage to your active fire Pokemon. And that is, and just one Steam Up is enough to shell trap for the knockout due to Vespiquen's weakness. And Azul takes a quick lead, going down to three prizes remaining.
Yep, now that does mean that eight damage counters are available for whichever Pokemon attacks into this Turtonator if we don't see a card like Lysander come down.
See an Ultra Ball discarding that Lysander that you were just talking about, as well as an Eevee.
And just look at the way that Premwatt has managed his resources. Very few Pokemon in the discard pile, only one double colorless in the discard pile, and he has so many cards at his disposal here in order to find a way to handle this Turtonator.
Yeah, Premwatt, I mean, both of these players, some of the best players in the world, they both know exactly how to play this matchup out. They both know exactly what they're doing, so you will see very few mistakes. If you're someone trying to learn current standard, how to play Pokemon, watching Prem and Azul, you could do a lot worse.
Right. Now we can see the Restrew Stretcher. It's just going to reset that unknown. Let him draw one more card and try again. He can also just hold that for after the end now. So he's going to see five cards, but essentially gets to see six just because of that unknown whenever he feels like drawing that one extra card.
Yeah, so Azul will be getting three cards. Prem will be getting five.
Yep.
Three is kind of the Prem taking a second to read the Turtonator. So
how many damage counters do I take?
How does this exactly work?
It's as long as it's not nine, I'm happy. Premwatt also has live draws with Ultra Ball that could thin out his hand even more to possibly even draw with Oranguru before he draws with the unknown. So a lot of cards that Premwatt could possibly see with the double VS Seeker and double colorless, though. He doesn't really care. He's got everything he wants.
Yeah, Prem's getting set up. There goes that Brooklet Hill, one of the new additions to the Volcanion deck.
Yep. Misses the opportunity to search out some water Pokemon. Unfortunate.
Prem going to consult his discard pile. He has to. So if you're Prem, you're just going to attack into this Turtonator if you have the knockout, right? You just accept that, oh, well, my Pokemon's going to get knocked out anyways.
Oh, definitely. Yeah, he says, you'll knock out Vespiquen in one shot anyways. Who cares if it has eight damage counters on it? Just going to see if there's a way that he can actually just use Mind Jack because of the water effect of it and hold on to his Vespiquen. Vespiquen is a great attacker later and not as risky. Doesn't depend on Azul's bench size. So great play here by Premwatt.
Prem going down to three prizes. The game is tied. And where does Azul go from here? Promotes Tapu Lele GX to the active position. Going to consult his discard pile. Prem not have that last combi, but besides that, nothing too relevant in his discard, in his prizes, rather.
Yeah, this matchup just really highlights the difference between the one prize and two prize trades. The fact that Azul hasn't been able to find any Baby Volcanion after that opening turn means that he isn't getting to any favorable trades when it comes to Promwat knocking out GX and EX Pokemon, when he's only going to be knocking out Pokemon like Zoroark and Vespiquen.
Yeah, one of the huge benefits of playing the deck that Promwat is, or any deck that relies heavily on non-EX Pokemon, is that every knockout your opponent takes, while they might be easier to take, they're only taking one prize for it. Whereas versus most decks, Promwat's going to be taking two prize knockouts off of EX or GX Pokemon. Like you said, Azul does have the ability to kind of focus on the non-EX Volcanion specifically in this matchup, but unfortunately that's not how his draws have gone, so I think Pram is in a pretty commanding position here.
Yeah, that's not good for Azul. He just has to manually attach to a Volcanion EX, and he can't even get a knockout on this Zoroark. He needs to do 20 damage.
Looks like Azul's going to Choice Band up that Starmie. Kind of irrelevant. Choice Band doesn't do anything in this matchup.
Yeah, so just wants to play it on a Pokemon that would not need a Floatstone in the future. So it's just a nice card to never see again.
And Promwat's in a really good position. Something I like to talk about with this Vespiquen deck, or decks like it, like Nightmare, some of the low energy cost attacking decks, is that very aggressive decks rather, is that they're in a constant state of rebuilding in which you attach your DCE, you take a knockout, your opponent knocks you out, and you have to kind of find the next Pokemon, the next DCE. But Pram actually has two energy on the board now, so he doesn't need to worry about that. He will not need to rebuild next turn, and next turn might be the end of the game after this Lysander.
Yeah, he doesn't need much to get going. N will probably never stop him with multiple energy on board, a Rangaroo to draw more cards, and such a commanding board state against what Azul has been able to do. Azul has nothing.
Yeah, we just talked about Azul trying to focus on non-EX knockouts to kind of slow Pram down a bit, but that's all Pram needs now is a non-EX knockout, just one thing.
Yep, we see Azul just stuck attaching to a Volcanion EX, and he's just going to try to slow this game down. Lysander on a Vaporeon. All Michael needs right now is a way to get out of the active spot here.
Looks like Versus Seeker is going to find a Lysander of Pram's own. Oh, maybe not. Pram just counting the number of Pokemon in his discard pile. Lysandering up that Volcanion EX. Standing in.
Yeah,
retreating,
just gets to stand in.
And taking the knockout. Michael Promwat wins a very, very convincing game one over Azul Garcia Grigio here. Wow, that's just, you would think, oh, Volcanion, that's a fire type. He's going to play against Vespiquen, that's a grass type. The weakness is going to work out, but that is not how things came together at all. Promwat was able to set up exactly how we wanted, including that Tech Vaporeon, and just win in dominating fashion versus Azul.
Yeah, and you can see Azul just smiles. He's like, that happens. I did everything that I could, honestly, that opening game. And just sometimes you just don't draw the cards to help you out. It looked pretty strong when he opened with the Volcanion. Took two combis in the first two turns, but I mean, if Michael does what he wants to do, he's going to win the game.
Yeah, definitely. And again, you know, not only are Azul and Promwat great friends, but at this point, you want to win the tournament, you want to do as well as you can, but you understand how matchups work. You understand, okay, I'm probably 40% to win this, maybe even a little less. So Azul has to kind of accept that and, you know, be willing to just move on if that happens. With that being said, we just saw Promwat have a dominant game one. How do things need to be different on either side for Azul to win this next game and hopefully this match?
I'm even considering going second if I'm Azul. Getting that first attack off might be the most relevant portion of the game for him, because he needs to have an explosive start anyways, which means he needs a combi knockout, and he needs to make sure that continues to go on for him. It's very risky. We've seen Night March players do that, where they say, all right, well, if I take the first knockout always, I'm going to win. But We'll see what Azul decides to do. He might also just think, if I get my board going, maybe Michael will just draw a little lighter this time, not get what he needs, and then I can win a game.
Two special charges prize for Pramawat. Again, this is a two-prize format or two-prize matchup for him, so hopefully they won't be too relevant. But that is going to be a consideration later in the game if things get to that point. And we are off for game two. Turtonator GX start for Azul attaches Brooklet Hill. Gonna find him either a Staryu or a Volcanion EX.
Yep, just looking through, trying to see what's going on there. And Turtonator's not a bad Pokemon to start with. He could sneak a lot of energy onto the board with a Nitro Tank GX. And Shelltrap, we saw it wasn't a bad attack. It was able to knock out some Pokemon, and that threat of 8 damage counters, although not terribly useful, still, it's nice to have.
Azul just passes the turn back.
He says, let me get my Vaporeon, man.
And it looks like... So he passes the turn back, and it looks like Pram is going to use that Brooklet Hill, both to get the Vaporeon and just look through his deck, see what's prized, determine that. He could even, like, maybe not take the Vaporeon if he has a Sycamore in his hand. Like,
right. He doesn't even need to grab it just yet. He can. He doesn't have the Eevee there, so... You can also just bluff. Oh, no, it's prized. Yeah. Azul, you're going to win now.
That is not outside of Pram's range at all, by the way.
Just frantically searching through the deck.
Oh, no. I mean, I don't think Azul would fall for that. Like I said, he knows what Pram's up to. They're pretty
good
friends.
A really slow start.
So Lysander on that Volcanion EX. And Pram is forced to pass the turn.
I think I would have taken my Vaporeon if his hand is this bad. Because if you drew into that Vaporeon, how bad would you feel?
Yeah, wow. Pram doesn't have a lot going on. Did you happen to see what was in his hand at all?
We see Zoroark and VS Seeker. Not too much. Really, he can just continue to Lysander. Also, with Brooklet Hill, you can only grab basic Pokemon, so it's just nice to look through your deck, though.
So rough start for Pramawat. He does have the Zoroark for next turn, but man, after saying how great this matchup was, what a rough start to run into.
Right, we see Azul. He gets to use that Brooklet Hill. He's looking to eye up his Staryu. He can see that his Starmie is prized just by looking through his deck. He knows that it's a 1-1 line. He's not going to get much use out of it. Of course, Free Retreat is nice, but it looks like he's eyeing up that Volcanion EX instead.
So Volcanion EX hits the board off of that Brooklet Hill. And that's how, this is the power of Brooklet Hill. Just, you know, one stadium card gets you all of this.
Yeah, it's nice to be able to pull a card from your deck like that. And Azul has nothing either, but Michael just drawing into double colorless energy. Mind Jack is going to do a little. He's got a Joy Band. So he can actually put a good chunk of damage on right now with 100.
He just has to Mind Jack, lone Zoroark versus this big field from Azul. But can Azul put anything together? Neither player has played any draw supporters this game.
Yeah, Azul has another energy, which means that Turtonator could use Bright Flame if it ever becomes active. That also means that Michael can't attack and take a knockout, or else he's just knocked out by the Turtonator.
The smile on Azul's face just saying, oh man, what is this matchup? What's happening?
What just happened here?
Looks like he's considering playing a Field Blower.
Yep.
Get that Choice Band off.
Also, expect him to use Brooklet Hill and grab another Pokemon out of his deck. Like that Staryu that he was eyeing up last turn. Just don't want to draw into it.
Yeah, he's going to activate the Brooklet Hill. So he is doing everything he needs to potentially draw more cards and get himself out of the situation. You know, he's thinning his deck out by taking these basic Pokemon. He's lessening the pressure a little bit by putting Pram off of Choice Band, but it might not be end up being enough. Who will be the first to draw a draw supporter or otherwise something relevant? Oh, Delinquent.
Oh. He's just gonna, you can just take the Brooklet Hill out and see what Michael was working with, and he sees Vespiquen, Floatstone, VS Seeker, all cards that aren't doing anything. Binds.
He finds Vespiquen. He had double colorless in his hand.
That is bad. And he can attack because
Jack.
Yeah, choice band gone doesn't means no knockout. Azul still can't find a way to get out of the active spot, though, so he passes.
Passes back. Does, oh.
One card.
Farewell letter?
No.
No, unfortunately. He just has to pass back.
Azul needs to find...
Well, what a top eight match.
Tapu Lele would find Olympia. Oh, there's
Ultra Ball from Pramawat.
Finally gets out. Azul has to be thinking, are you kidding me? I almost got to steal a game, but no.
All right, so this from this point on, turn six or whatever this is, the game should operate roughly as normal. Pramawat
at least for Pramawat.
Yeah. Sure. Pramawat will likely be searching up a Shaymin EX, and that's the power of this Vespiquen deck, is he can really kind of go off after the Shaymin. He could draw any amount of, you know, Pokemon, Forest, or Giant Plants. He could just really get set up. It's kind of not the same as a lot of the decks that would just put a Shaymin or a Tapu Lele into play. He can do a lot even after he's played his supporter.
Yeah, it looks like he's choosing to use the Tapu Lele rather than the Shaymin. Gets a Professor Sycamore, which means he gets to see more cards in the beginning, but loses that impact of Shaymin drawing into a supporter and then really going off. But he just says, I just need to live. I can also play this double colorless energy on Tapu Lele, and at least there's an attacker rather than just using Sky Return at a later turn.
Right, and there's the Combee, there's an Eevee, and if you're Azul, you just got to be... groaning in your seat as it's very likely here that Pram's definitely going to last through this game through at least a few more turns, but we see he has the Vespiquen in hand, he has draw supporters in hand, he is fully back into this game.
Yeah, now his hand looks better than what it did, but it's still bad. He's got two Sycamore, two VS Seeker, which means that if he ever wants to draw again, he's just going to lose a lot of value.
And he's going to take the knockout. Now that he's safe from being benched out of the game, knocks out that Turtonator GX, takes two prize cards, going down to four. Michael Pramawat one game away from entering the semifinals here. Azul has to still do some work, win this game and the next.
Yep, over on Azul's side, he does have that Turtonator. But, did he draw into anything relevant? He's just been sitting there with that same hand of... do nothing, potentially could just Bright Flame here and try to find a prize card that could help him.
Gonna take a look at Pramawat's discard pile. Man. Jeremy kept saying it last round, Pram is lucky. It's unlucky to start in the way Pram did, but Pram always keeps it on the edge of our seats with that.
If you're gonna
top
have
deck.
A game that you draw so poorly, at least your opponent followed along in the same suit.
Right.
Lysander is a good card for Azul to use. Gets rid of that Combee, and he doesn't have to lose the energies that he would with a Bright Flame because he's using Shell Trap. 20 damage is enough when you get to do weakness with on Combee.
Tapu Lele GX gets sent to the active position. Acrobike has to decide between a Lysander and a Shaymin EX. A lot of cards in Pramawat's hand. So I imagine that he will be taking the Lysander. He does. Setup wouldn't really do much for him right now. And he's just going to go ahead and play the Lysander.
It says, you know what? I'm not doing too much, but you've done nothing, and this 60 will start to add up soon.
Yeah, rescue stretchers the Combee back to hopefully evolve into Vespiquen next turn. That's 60 damage. Azul draws top deck's basic fire energy.
Yeah, that's one of the problems when you run 14 basic energies is that you might run into them instead of supporter sometimes, and unfortunately for Azul, that's just what happened.
Azul doesn't look like he has too much going on in his hand now, or at least considering his options.
Yeah, it's really not pretty to attach to the active Volcanion. You would just be helping the Tapu Lele attack you even harder, and you would still need to find one more fire energy to even attack, and that wouldn't even be a knockout. You could try to retreat, but you're not doing anything in that sense. So he's just going to focus on his bench, and hopefully that'll help. But yeah, he did find a Sycamore to use.
Yeah, so attaches Choice Band and basic fire energy, finds a Sycamore. Is that his first draw supporter this game? I think he just played Lysander and Delinquent in the earlier turns.
Yeah, I guess he found the Sycamore off of the prize cards.
The one prize?
Yeah, the prize card.
Potentially. There's a Brooklet Hill. Gonna go ahead and activate that. Searching his deck for a basic water Pokemon. Fails the search.
So yep.
Getting a look at his deck.
Doesn't mean he doesn't have one. It just means he doesn't want one right now. He's already seen how bad it is when your Volcanion EX gets Lysandered up and you can't do anything. So there's no need to bench one right now.
Yeah, that's one of the interesting things is that he has to... he can attack with a non-EX Volcanion. That's something he wants to do. But he has to play those Volcanion EX onto the board pretty much either way so he can use Steam Up, right? So they're always going to be liabilities on the bench.
Right, and he'd like to have Floatstones for those Volcanion EX for situations like this. But then you have to worry about your opponent's Field Blower, so it really is just a battle of who has what when.
Here's a Sycamore. Primawatt does finally decide to fire that off, getting rid of a lot of resources, but just decides that it's worth it for a fresh new hand of 7 cards.
Yep, would really like to see Vaporeon, and there it is.
And there it is. Now all of Primawatt's Stage 1 Pokemon will be water type in addition to their normal types. They will be hitting everything on the board for weakness.
Yeah, and that's very good for Michael. He's able to find Unknown and get even more Pokemon into the discard pile for potential B revenges. Klefki's a Klefki. can put the Klefki onto an Unknown.
Yeah, Klefki only really exists in the matchup, even in this deck for the most part, to just be put into the discard pile. Although it did help Primawatt out in day one versus Mega Rayquaza.
Yeah. Every once in a while, it's more than just a plus power for your B revenge.
Another Combi hits the board on Primawatt's side. Considering attaching a Floatstone to that Zoroark or anywhere else on the board. Gonna go ahead and count his Pokemon. Maybe we can get an updated count as well. Nice shot of the discard pile there.
Oh, that's more than 6. So he's, looks like 11? 11?
Yeah. So 11 Pokemon, more than enough with that Aqua effect in play.
Yep, he's just going to look through with Brooklet Hill. Yeah. Of course, he has no targets in his deck, but it's just nice to see what's in there. We see 2 double colorless along with plenty more Pokemon just in case he does need to get more in. I don't see that being relevant, though.
Failing the search. Shuffling up. And we're going to see a stand-in with this Zoroark leading into a knockout.
Yep, just gets to use Mind Jack. And he's also a water Pokemon for the time being, so pretty good knockout there.
All right, Primawatt has taken another commanding lead. He just needs to take 2 more prizes, knock out any EX or GX Pokemon on Azul's side of the board, and he will advance to the semifinals here in Madison. Can Azul take 5 prizes before that happens? He's going to have to put a lot together. I'm not sure that he can do it. There's still going to be turns remaining in this game. What is Azul looking to do this turn to at least try to push himself towards that, 1% or 2% that he can win?
Well, his chances are abysmal, to say the least. He has Turtonator, which means that he can use Burning Flame, and discarding those energies means that he won't be return knocked out by the Tapu Lele, who is also part water because of Vaporeon.
Tapu Lele's not. It's only Stage 1.
Excuse me. Yeah. So, well, he doesn't have to worry about any extra damage coming down because of the energy effect of Tapu Lele, but he still has to dodge double colorless energies. So, he needs to find an N, of course.
He didn't Wonder Tag for an N.
Yeah, and then getting Primawatt down to just 2 cards because and he doesn't have an Oranguru down is great. Michael could potentially just draw as bad as he did in the opener, and we could see more of the same. Just really needs to dodge double colorless energy.
So here is step 1, Wonder Tag for an N. Reduce Michael's hand down to just 2 cards. Azul gets 5. Will it be enough? You see the very serious look on Primawatt's face, one of the very few times in his life he's serious, focused, looking right into the camera.
It's like, man, can I just find this double colorless?
Players cutting each other's decks. Let's see what Cramble.
Doesn't even look. All right, he sees Ultra Ball.
Ultra Ball Sycamore, I believe.
That would be good.
Five cards in Azul's hand. Going to consult the discard pile, see what Pram has played, specifically see how many Pokemon he has, see his versus count. I know his supporter, Pram's supporter count is actually really low right now because he's used at least two versus seekers that he discarded off of Sycamore. So he does have a fairly low chance of, you know, drawing into a card that can draw him cards off of this end. Though I do think I saw a Sycamore in his hand.
Yep. Definitely could be, but yeah, we will just see that Burning Flame, Bright Flame, excuse me, taking the knockout. Finds a Shaymin.
Vespa Queen gets promoted. Shaymin's going to draw him four cards here.
And, there it is.
There's a double colorless energy. He has 13 Pokemon in the discard pile. That is the game and the match. Michael Pramawat advances to the semifinals here in Madison, chasing his fifth regional win.